is more kind of explosive way of digital communication system, both at transmitter and receiver end. We have covered with a formatting block where this was a part of, you know, sampling and quantization, where it tries to convert your analog information source to digital signal. And we need to encode this. We need to convert this digital signal to binary or any MRE representation of the representation that we have with us. So we usually go for binary representation. We did not spend much time on this encoding part, but this unit 4 specifically deals with this source encoding part. But we have already, you know, covered a block which is ahead of this source encoder, which is multiplexing. Okay, so multiplexing comes after channel encoding, and then we try to, you know, pulse modulate and bandpass modulate and try to throw it into the channel. In fact, we are done with pulse modulation as well. But before encoding it into pulse, or before converting your bits into pulses and then throwing into the channel, before doing that process, we'll need to look into how the digital symbols are converted into binary bits. Okay. Although we have not, you know, spent much time on it, this is the unit where it focuses more on the source encoding in CS1 and channel encoding in your CS2 part. Okay, so we'll start with unit 4, okay, which is information theory. So this basics of this information theory is valid for not only just for digital communication, but many other fields, including quantum computing and image processing or speech processing kind of techniques as well. Okay, so all your MPEG-4s or JPEG compression techniques all need a basic understanding of this the particular concepts involved in unit 4. Okay. All right. So before I get into the actual gist of this information theory, we need to have, you know, a few theoretical understanding about what we are dealing with. The means of communication, in the sense the channel which is used for communication, it could be wired or wireless. If it's, you know, wired, it could be twisted pair, or it could be coaxial, or it could be optical. Okay, it could be anything of wired nature, or wireless. It could be wireless communication for mobile networks, or it could be for Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. So whatever could be the nature of the mean of communication, none of those means produce error-free communication. Okay, that should be the first of the point that you should know that. No means of communication, whether it could be wired or wireless, produce error-free communication. Okay, so our job is to make the communication error-free, but unfortunately the nature of the channel itself where it actually affects our communication, which will in turn of, you know, quantification of this error-free communication. In other words, we need to have a more accurate transmission of these digital signals by reducing the error in probability. We call the error in probability as one of the merits of this digital communication. In case of analog communication, signal to noise ratio was one of the parameters which with respect to which we evaluated the efficiency of a communication system. But with respect to digital communication, the error in probability, because it involves bits in digital communication system, as we try to represent each of the sample with respect to bits, so any errors in transmission of in the channel will have the errors in with respect to error in probability. So probability error is one of the key ingredient or key parameter which is used to evaluate any digital communication system. As I was saying, the channel, which is a mean of communication, as long as that, you know, channel noise exists, we cannot say that, you know, our communication will be free of errors. Okay. So, and with the study, it has been seen that the probability of error, we'll see this, you know, probability of error in with much detail in digital modulation in CS2 course, but just, you know, taking that in prior to that extensive discussion, I can just simply say that this error in probability for any communication system, is especially with respect to digital communication system, it varies exponentially. Okay, so this is proportional to asymptotic variation, where it's e power minus k times eb, where k is simply, you know, a positive constant, where eb is referred as energy per bit. Okay, so I come again, the error in probability or probability error is proportional to exponential minus k times eb, where k is a positive constant and eb is referred as energy per bit, as with the relation of these error in probability and energy per bit, it seems that more the energy per bit, lesser is the error probability, or the communication between transmitter and error receiver would be more error free. Okay, so but in turn, this energy per bit can be written in terms of signal power. It's energy simply a ratio of power to the time. Okay, the rate of change of power is energy. So the signal power over the bit period, where it occupies, I mean, the each bit occupies, you know, TB bit of duration, is can be written in terms, I mean, energy can be expressed in terms of those two parameters, or can write this as signal power times RB, where RB is transmission bit rate. Okay, so this is has the unit of per second. So I have just replaced 1 over TB with RB. So EB is related with respect to, I think the definition of the power should be the other way around. The signal
power. It is power into time, sir.
Okay, signal power, I'm sorry. So this is rate of change of energy. Yeah, this is right. Okay, and in turn, this 1 over TB can be written as the rate of transmission bit rate as RB. Okay, so signal power is rate of change of energy. So EB represents energy per bit, TB is your bit duration, and 1 over TB can in turn be written as just RB, which is transmission bit rate. Okay, so this implies this EB, energy per bit, which on which we are concentrating much, is the ratio of signal power to bit rate. Okay, so we are in the process of making this energy per bit as high as possible, only to make the error probability, to reduce the error probability, to make the transmission more efficient, or to make it more error free. But it appears that the energy per bit depends on, in turn, depends on two quantities, one is signal power or bit rate. So in order to, say, in order to reduce PE, okay, in order to reduce PE, we should increase EB because of the relation between those two quantities. So in order to increase energy per bit, either we should increase the signal power or and so we can do both or either one of these, reduce bitrate. Okay, so we can do either of these, either increase the signal power or reduce the transmission bit rate, or do both in order to increase the energy per bit. But with practical limitations or physical limitation, we cannot increase the signal power beyond a certain limit, because we cannot just keep on supplying infinite amount of power just to reduce error in probability, which is not practically feasible. So with that practical limitation, to reduce error probability further, we have only left with one option of reducing RP, which is the rate of information, rate of transmission of information digits. Okay, so thus the price to be paid for reducing PE is reducing a reduction in the transmission rate. Okay, so in other words, to make PE approaching to zero, because error in probability should be as less as possible. So as PE tends to zero, this implies that this RB should also be tend to zero, right? And hence EB will be tending to infinity, because EB will be tending to infinity, and hence e power minus infinity would be zero, right? So with that simple mathematical relation, it appears that we should be taking this information transmission rate to be approaching zero. But this is practically impossible, as you know that transmission bit rate represents the amount of information transmitted over a second, right? If that itself reduces zero, that it's against to the actual meaning of the communication itself, right? So it appears that the presence of channel noise, okay, in the means of communication makes impossible to achieve error-free communication. Okay, so this was the thought process amongst the engineers until mid 20th century, and at around 1948, a famous scientist known as Shannon, okay, came up with a theory that is published as is its seminar paper. So if it's possible, I think I have that paper as well. So this was published in 1948 by C. Shannon under the title of A Mathematical Theory of Communication. If you are interested, this PDF is also available on online, but also I'll try to share on my webpage as well, because it's an intensive explanation of how he tries to mathematically try to reform the definition of the probability of making it as low as possible by retaining a finite amount of rate of transmission. Okay, but the gist of this paper can be explained in simple, a single sentence, where it is possible to achieve an error-free communication. Okay, so the gist of the paper was simply as, with the presence of, I'll just make it a sentence so that it will be easy to refer back. So the presence of random disturbance in a channel does not define any limit on transmission accuracy. Okay, it doesn't affect or doesn't influence how accurate was the transmission, but instead it defines a limit on the information rate. Okay, for which an arbitrary small error in probability can be achieved. Okay, I'll explain this. But this is known as Shannon's limit or Shannon's theorem, where he says that to obtain PE tending to zero, okay, we need it is not necessary to make RB tending to zero. So this is not necessary to make RB tending to zero, but alternatively, what we can set is to achieve this goal, where we need to reduce the probability error, but it can be alternatively attained by maintaining RB less than C, where C represents the channel capacity. Okay, so the channel capacity is the, you know, by the English meaning of itself, it says that that every channel, every means of communication has its own capacity to take the information from the transmitter and, you know, throw it into the receiver. Okay, the limit of the channel capacity, with keeping that in mind, and if it keep your transmission rate or bit rate lesser than the channel capacity itself, you can achieve not error-free communication, but to such an extent where probability of error is very minimum. Okay, so the limit of the transmission depends on the setting of this parameter, information rate less than the capacity. So this complete unit is about describing this theorem in a more extensive way, and dealing with all the parameters which will which can be taken from this concept. Okay, so all along now we have used a kind of a phrase called as rate of information transmission. Okay, so I have been talking about this phrase, where we have given a mathematical notation as RB, where it represents the rate of information transmission. The B represents, we have been using the bits to represent each of the sample of the analog signal. So information, can it be measured? So with a common sense says that information is just an information. It cannot be quantitatively be measured with respect to any information for that matter. So can we find out a method to quantify this information and try to build upon that concept? Okay, so the concept that you are going to understand is how information is measured. Okay, this is given in detail in the paper as well, but we'll take only what is required for our discussion. Okay, so let's try to understand how information can be measured with respect to common sense. Okay, so information is all about interpretation by human being. Okay, so with respect to common sense, say hypothetically, you assume that you read a newspaper and you see there are the three headlines. The first headline is, say hypothetically speaking, there will be, say, a daylight tomorrow. Okay, hypothetically speaking, the second, the headline in the newspaper says that India invades, say, Nepal. So there have been, politically, in India and Nepal have their own differences among the border issues. So let's say that, all of a sudden, the newspaper headline says that India is invading Nepal. If the third headline, in other words, if of this nature, Nepal invading India. Okay, hypothetically speaking, so these are the three headlines, you know, headlines that you see in a newspaper in the morning. The reader, the newspaper reader, will hardly notice the first headline, right? This is the first headline. The reader will hardly notice this because this is a very, you know, common feature where he'll have a least focus on such kind of headlines unless and until he or she lives in a North Pole or the South Pole region, or if there is you know, it's a rainy season, unless and otherwise this statement of, you know, the first headline will not be surprising to him. Okay, but the reader will be very, very interested in the second news. Okay, because this really, you know, catches the reader's attention that India is invading Nepal. But more interestingly, about the third statement, this is more surprising than the first two, right? So this item will attract much more interest than the other two headlines. Okay, so from the viewpoint of common sense, the first headline conveys hardly any information. Right, so this is the statement. It doesn't convey information. Okay, my idea is to draw to the point that the understanding of information. Okay, so the first statement definitely doesn't convey any information, but the second statement, it contains large amount of information. Okay, and the third contains definitely larger amount of information. Okay, so if we look at the probabilities of occurrences of these three events, since we are in the process of quantifying the information, say if I try to relate with respect to their probabilities, okay, or the occurrences of these three events, we find that the probability of occurrence of the first event is unity, because it's a certain event. Say if it's a summer, it's definitely, a certain event that to that saying that, you know, there will be a daylight tomorrow. All right, so with respect to the second one, okay, the second, obviously, the probability will be less than one. Okay, where somewhere, you know, in between 0 and 1. But with respect to the third, the event, it is almost an impossible event, right? So this is an impossible event, and hence the P could be almost, you know, close to zero. Okay, so if an event of low probability occurs like this, it causes greater surprise, right? So this gives you a greater surprise. So I'm trying to convey in a most meaningful manner here. So, okay, so this conveys definitely more information. So the greater surprise means it contains more information. Although I have already written that, but I need to make it with respect to a kind of common sense point of view, right? So the information is connected with the element of surprise, so which is a result of uncertainty or unexpectedness. The more unexpected the event, the greater the surprise, and hence the more information. Okay, so in other words, I can summarize this as, okay, more the unexpectedness, okay, the greater the surprise, all right, and hence more is the information. All right, so the probability of occurrence of such event is definitely very, very less, correct? So more the unexpected in the sense, the probability of occurrence of that event is very, very low. Okay, the other way around is definitely when there is no surprise in the event, or the probability of occurrence of that event is more, then definitely it conveys less amount of information. Okay, so this, from the point of view of common sense, the amount of information received from a message is directly related to the uncertainty, or inversely related to the probability of its occurrence. Okay? So this implies that, okay, this implies that if the probability P of occurrence of a message signal, say if probability, if I try to mathematically formulate this, say if probability of occurrence of a message or an event for that matter, and say is P, of an information gained from the message is I, okay, then it is evident that as P tends to 1, if this probability is more certain, as I told, this implies that it conveys least amount of information. The message conveys less amount of information, and when and the probability is very low, or if there is uncertainty in the event that is occurring, or if the information or the message is or the event itself is very uncertain to occur, or if there is an element of surprise in that message, the information content in that message will also be very, very high. With this relation between probability and the information, this suggests that the information I can be quantitatively measured, or it could be approximated to, just not the inverse, remember, where when I is tending to 0, P is not infinity, correct? So when I is tending to 0, the probability is 1, which is more certain, but when probability is very, very low, the information is tending to infinity. So we can mathematically write the relation between the information and the probability of occurrence as this way, where it is inversely related to the logarithmic of the probability. Okay, so this actually is one. Yes, please.
So here, basically the surprise over here, as you put it, it's basically an analog of the energy.
Yeah, and it's not an energy for that matter. So I'm not talking about anything with respect to the power or the energy content in it. I'm talking about the information that particular event is conveying to the user.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so I have not, I've not converted anything to bits. It's not the process of transformation from analog to digital of anything of that nature. I'm just, sticking on to the information with a common sense and the message that, that it's conveying to the user or whoever is the receiver for that matter. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Slowly we'll build up onto that. Don't worry. So this is with respect to the common sense, but with respect to engineering measure, we can put it in this fashion. Engineering measure of information, how it can be understood. Okay. So let's try to show that from an engineering point of view, the information content of a message is definitely is inconsistent with the intuitive measure. So this is of an intuitive measure, that this expression that we got of. How do we justify with respect to engineering point of view? Okay, so first we should understand what is the responsibility of an engineer. So an engineer is responsible for the efficient transmission of messages, correct? So its only job is to make sure that the information transmitted from the transmitter efficiently reaches the receiver. So for this service, for the efficient transmission of, I'll put it this, so this is with respect to efficient transmission of messages. Okay, so for the efficient transmission of the message, the engineer will charge a customer an amount proportional to the information to be transmitted. Okay, so the cost of this efficient transmission, okay, is nothing but with respect to amount of information. Okay, but in other words, in reality, the engineer is charging the customer in proportional to the time that message occupies the channel bandwidth. So in other words, so this cost is actually, okay, so this cost is actually in proportional to the time that the message occupies channel bandwidth. Okay, if the user is using the bandwidth for more amount of time, obviously the cost for that particular transmitter will be high. Okay, so with respect to the cost involvement with engineering perspective, it appears that he is charging for the amount of time that the user is utilizing the bandwidth. So in short, from an engineering point of view, the amount of information in a message is proportional to the time required to transmit the message. Okay, so shorter the time, you will incur less cost. More the time that you are utilizing the bandwidth, or the more the time that you are taking to transmit your information from transmitter to receiver, the more amount of cost is going to incur in your transmission. Okay, so we will now show that this concept of information will also lead to the same common sense perspective that we have just quantitatively put it as I proportional to log of 1 over p. Okay, so this implies that message with higher probability, okay, message with higher probability can be transmitted in shorter time. Okay, since we are talking in terms of probability, we need to measure the amount of information, but here it's not about the amount of information in reality, it is about the time taken to transmit from one end to another. So we can utilize shorter time of transmission for the messages which are very obvious or which are more certain, or in terms of probability which have got higher probability. And conversely, message with lower probability, which are more less frequently to occur, can take large time. Okay, so this was actually one of the concept which was done in a famous Morse code as well, where alphabets were converted to dashes and dots, or it could be pulses of height, plus A and minus A, in other words. So in Morse code, each letter was represented by a certain combination of these dots and dashes, correct? So each of them were called as code word, where those were combinations of dots and dashes, or say pulses of height, say plus A and minus A, in other words. Okay, so which has a certain length, each code word had a certain length. Okay, so obviously for efficient transmission, shorter code words were assigned to, say, for efficient transmission, shorter code words, assigned the letters, say E, T, say the vowels like, you know, A and O. Okay, so for the longer code words, which were less frequent to occur, the letters like X, right? These are very less frequent to occur, like K, could be Q, or it could be Z, or, you know, like that. Okay, so the shorter code words where E, T, and A and O, like vowels, are very frequently occur in any English, sentences or words for that matter. So these were assigned with shorter code words, and the longer code words like these, letters are which are very less frequent to occur were assigned with longer code words. Okay, so which gave more efficient way of transmission. With similar to the digital communication system, we can say that number of, say, if I try to put it in a table, say number of messages and number of bits used for each message. Okay. If I put it into, these quantities, then I can say that, say if there are two messages to be sent, say M1 and M2, okay, so which are equally likely to occur. Remember, M1 and M2, if I say they are equiprobable, we can assign digits 0 to M1 and 1 to M2, and we'll be needing just, two bits to represent, just to represent one signal or one, bit to represent each of these messages. Okay, this bit will go to 0 and 1 accordingly, the messages M1 and M2. Okay, so with respect to, say, 4, this is very trivial but very important as per perspective of amount of information content in those. Okay, so if there are 4 messages, so obviously we'll be assigning our standard encoding of these messages, we'll be needing 2 bits to represent, right? So 2 bits to represent 4 messages, 1 bit to represent just 2 messages, and accordingly it will go with, if there are M1 to M8, say if there are M1 to, say, M8, definitely we'll be in need of 3 bits to represent. As you can see, quantitatively, it is very clear that with respect to the second case, these 4 messages, M1 to M4, take twice as much transmission time as required by each of the 2 equiprobable messages, M1 and M2. These occupy just 1 bit period. The set of M1 to M4, each of those messages occupy 2 bit periods. Correct. So the amount of information or the number of time that they occupy the channel bandwidth is obviously the double that of the case with just 2 messages. And obviously the same with the set of 8 messages, where they take 3 bit duration when compared to the 2 sets of messages M1 and M2. Okay, so it can be seen that we are already know about this fact, but let it put in a more engineering way, where it can be seen that we need log to the base n, okay, binary digits to encode.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So does each message over here, this M1 to M8, does it represent a letter, number, word, or like an?
It could be anything. So it could be anything in this matter. Okay. So 0, 0 probably represent, probably a letter itself. If there are 4 messages, say if I want to transmit 4 set of messages, then I need to convert into, you know, digital representation. Then I would be needing, you know, 2 bits to represent that if I'm using binary digits. Similarly, with respect to 2 messages. So 2 messages, it could be 2 words, 2 letters, or it could be anything. You know, it doesn't matter for this, you know, perspective. It could be 2 samples of analog signal as well. I'm just sticking to more generic form of, you know, saying it as simply as a message. Okay, I'm not relating with respect to any particular form of the message.
Okay, so it could be anything.
It could be anything. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so we'll be needing in general log n base to 2 binary digits to encode, you know, each, you know, message signal. Okay, each message for that matter. Okay, so but we know that, but each of these message is equiprobable. Okay, so with equally likely messages, okay, with equally likely messages, we know that the probability of each of those messages would be obviously 1 over n. In case of 4, it would be 1 over 4 for each of those messages to appear. For in case of 8 messages, so 1 over 8 would be the probability of each message to appear. So we would be in need of, you know, the probability of each messages would be just, you know, 1 over n with respect to, you know, equiprobable messages. So this implies that from engineering viewpoint, the information, okay, the information I contained in a message, okay, the information contained in a message, okay, is I proportional to log to the n, or since each of these messages is equilikely, I can replace this n with simply 1 over p. Okay, so or I can replace this constant of proportionality with some, you know, random constant, positive constant k. Okay, so this is actually very similar to what, you know, the common sense of a point of view that we this was, you know, deduced. Okay, so for sake of simplicity, we take this constant of proportionality to be simply 1. Okay, so this implies that I would be, the information can be measured, you know, quantitatively as inverse of logarithmic of the probability. Okay, so this, since we have taken, you know, binary digits, the obviously the base is 2, but in general for say R array digits, it's not binary now, it's R array digits. Okay, we can write information as base to the R, but visually we'll stick with, you know, R as, you know, 2 itself, but we use R is equal to 2 throughout our, you know, course of digital communication. Okay, so this implies the unit of information is bits. Okay, so I will be using a base of logarithmic unless otherwise stated. So we'll be skipping this, you know, base 2 flow of the course, but you should make sure that, or you should keep it in your mind that, you know, the logarithmic base is 2 always. Okay, so this is, you know, the basic foundation to where it quantifies the amount of information content in any message or in any sample is inversely proportional to the logarithmic of the probability. Okay, so that is very much a requirement as we proceed in the course. Okay, let me take a few minutes to cover a few more things related to this. One important concept that is required is average information, okay, per message. This is known as entropy of a source. Okay, these are all basic definitions or basic concepts which will be taken further with a greater extent. Okay, let me try to say what would be the average amount of information per message if the messages are, say, unequally likely to occur. We have taken a case with equally likely case, but it's also true for unequal probabilities, where each of the message will have an amount of information I with log base to 1 over pi, where pi represents the probability of occurrence of that ith message. Okay, so this basic relation between the information and the probability will be intact even in case with unequally likely events. Okay, please keep that in mind. Okay, with respect to that, we'll try to formulate the average amount of information present in a message, which is also termed as entropy of a source. Consider, for this assumption is most important. Let's consider, say, a memoryless source, okay, emitting messages m1, m2, say up to mn. Okay, so it's a memoryless source implies that, okay, the meaning of this memoryless source implies that message are emitted independent of the previous. Okay, so these are independent emission of the messages by the source, and hence it is called as memoryless source. Each message m1 to mn will have the probability, let us say, if this m1 message is occurring with respect to a probability p1 and this has p2 and up to pn, if that is the case, then we know that the summation of all these probabilities should sum up to 1. Okay, so this is a basic definition of the the assumption that we are going to make to define average amount of information. Remember, each information here is unequally distributed with respect to probability, so it's unequally likely. Okay, the amount of information of a message, say mi in general, can be written as ii. Okay, in long run I will try to omit that base 2, but for initial purposes I'll just retain that base. Okay, so this can be defined as amount of information contained in each message. So therefore, the mean, or you can call it as average, okay, information per message. So this is one of the important quantity which is required for the source encoder part. Okay, that's the reason I'm just putting it in a more detailed way. Okay, so this is the average information per message by the source is basically each information is each information is occurring with respect to a probability pi is nothing but it's a weighted average of the information. Is weighted average of ii. Okay, so which is nothing but, and this is defined as the entropy. Okay, so this is defined as entropy, which is represented as h. Okay, so in more specific with respect to notation, we'll use h of m because it's a message, entropy of the message is denoted mathematically as h of m. So this h of m is simply the weighted average, where there are n messages which is occurring with probability pi times ii. The average will should have the denominator. The denominator is simply the summation of all the probabilities which we know that which gets summed to one. And hence I'm just avoiding that step which represents 1 over p1 plus p2 and up to pn. Okay, so this represents the entropy, as we know that the information ii can be represented as logarithmic of 1 over pi. So this is a point from which I will eliminate that base 2. Okay, even entropy can have unit of bits. In other words, this is concisely written in most of the resources as minus of summation i1 to n pi log of pi. Okay, so this is entropy of the source, or in other words, this is average amount of information per message emitted by the source. Okay, so this is interesting to find that the message probability distribution. So the probability pi will yield the entropy. So we can try to find out, or the interesting point here it could be, for what value of pi we can get maximum entropy, as that represents the maximum average information per message. So we can find out what is that value of pi will give you maximum entropy. Obviously, that could be the value of equally probable messages, where pi would be simply 1 over n. So, but still, we'll have to prove that mathematically, which can be done in the upcoming sessions.